Go ahead and take out your notes with me as I share with you. You know, if I had to summarize the Bible, I'd do it like this. I would split the Bible into two parts, the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament is the passing of leadership from one generation to the next generation, right? I mean, we read the Old Testament, it's just from one generation to the next generation, the leadership. The New Testament, two words, love and forgiveness. Susan Valentine, their mom, did all of that. She walked the talk. Well, today, we're going to be ending our series titled Make Your Mark, and we're going to be talking about leadership. Now, when every one of us said yes to Jesus, when we lifted our hands and allowed Jesus to come into our hearts, Jesus marked our lives, which means we're all leaders here. Don't think you're not a leader, because when you walk out these doors, people are watching you. As a Christian, they walk in to see how you act, how you behave. They want to see what makes you so different. You're 10 times different, the Bible says. The day you said yes to Jesus, I will follow you, that makes you a leader. Jesus marked your life. Now, in the Bible, in 2 Timothy is a letter written by Paul when he was in prison in Rome, and it's probably the last recorded letter written by Paul. And he is passing the leadership from one generation to the next generation. Paul loved Timothy. And his writings to Timothy provides us with valuable insights and life lessons. There's a quote that goes something like this. It says, "The greatness of a man is not how much wealth he acquires, but in his integrity and his ability to affect those around him positively." I'll give you an example of that. Affect those around him. Back in the 1800s, the late 1800s, there lived a missionary named Hudson Taylor. Hudson Taylor founded the China Inland Missions. Hudson Taylor lived in China for 51 years. He started up 125 schools. He's responsible for bringing over 800 missionaries into China and directly resulted in 18,000 Christian converts. 18,000 people said yes. No other missionary in the 19th century since the Apostle Paul has had a wider vision, covered more geographical area in evangelism than Hudson Taylor. In fact, even after Hudson Taylor's death, his impact and influence still follows out through China. Now, the communist China government didn't want not having control over that. So they commissioned a writer to write a story on Hudson Taylor, discrediting him, dishonoring him, squashing Hudson Taylor. When they hired this guy, they put a gun to his head, sorta, you know. He was forced to do this. So as he started looking through the records, searching through a lot of information about Hudson Taylor, he had a change of heart. He started to see his saintly character, his godly life, and all of a sudden, in less than a year, after studying, researching, looking through records, this guy said, "I had enough. I have a change of heart. It's going to cost me my life, but I'm going to lay down my pen." He renounced his atheism, and he gave his life to Christ. Listen, we all realize, whether we realize it or not, our example leaves an impression on others. Influence is a powerful mark of leadership. John Maxwell, American author on leadership, and speaker, pastor, he has probably one of the best definitions of leadership. He says this: "Leadership is not about titles, position, or flow charts. It's about one life influencing another." So when it comes to making your mark through leadership, when we follow Jesus, we're all leaders. We don't have a choice. Jesus has marked our lives. It's not about titles or positions. It's about one life influencing another. Today, I want to show you how anyone and everyone can learn to mark your life through leadership. Now, there are three principles we're going to talk about today. It's from the Apostle Paul. He leads us and he helps us make our mark. If you let these three principles flow into your life, it'll give you a strong foundation for life and for ministry. It's the passing of leadership from one generation to the next generation. Three principles in your notes. Here's your first one. Number one is this: be a lifelong learner. Be a lifelong learner. I want you to read with me this in 2 Timothy 3:12 through 15. Everybody, all together, nice and loud, like you're worshiping. Read that loud. Okay? 2 Timothy 3:12 to 15, ready, go. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it from. And now, from infancy, you have known, stop right there, the Holy Scriptures. Circle that, the Holy Scriptures. And then continue on with me, ready, go. Which you are able to wise for salvation. Nice and loud. Faith in Christ Jesus. Timothy was the first of the second generation of Christians. He became a Christian through his mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois. For Timothy, the Holy Scriptures are the books of the Old Testament. The Old Testament is important because it points us to Jesus. The Old Testament gives us evidence of the coming of the Messiah. So this is what Paul is saying in this scripture. Renew your commitment to fresh learning. Renew your commitment to fresh learning. It's like this. If you learn one new thing every day, one new skill every day, or one new insight, one new thing every day, in a year's time, you would have learned 365 new things, right? What's that called? Compound interest. Yeah. Take the initiative to discover new truths about yourself and about God. Now, dig deeply, because when you do, you'll discover materials from which out of great futures are created. Some people say, but what if I make a mistake? What do you mean if? We're all going to make mistakes, but we learn and we grow from those mistakes. We learn from those mistakes. Embrace failures, mistakes. Because they only make us uniquely who we are, but they also teach us powerful, powerful lessons. Hey, I got a funny story for you. I'm going to share this with you. I want to find out this. How many, raise a hand, show of hands, how many grandparents here? Grandparents, come on, up with the hands. There we go. Look, even up there. Nice. Okay. Now, this is for especially the grandparents, and even if you're, it's for everybody, even if you have children. Now, I have a grandchild, and she's 10 years old now. And when my wife was in the hospital having this child, my granddaughter, I thought, geez, you know, I raised two kids already, and I'm done, you know. As a grandparent, you kind of sometimes you think about this. I'm done already. I don't want to babysit this baby. I was thinking of me, myself, and I was real selfish, and I didn't want to babysit anymore. I'm done with that. Well, anyway, driving to the hospital, by the time I get there, and all grandparents go through this, but when you hold that child for the first time, you know, there's something supernatural that happens. All of a sudden, I had a change of heart. And I was telling my daughter, you know, I watched this baby five times, six times if you want a week, you know? I tell you, the Holy Spirit just ambushed me. And I was stricken. So you're holding that baby. And you don't have to tell any grandparent. We all go through this. We all say this. We look at that baby for the first time, your first one, and you say this. This is the most beautiful, intelligent baby, right? We all do that. And then we ask this question. As a grandparent, you look at that child and you go, how can this child, how can intelligence skip over a generation, right? We all think that. Well, here's a mistake, because some time ago I did this. I was talking about this in service, and I didn't realize that my daughter had walked in. And she usually comes sit up front. If I know she was there, I wouldn't have said anything. But she came in late, so she decided to sit up on the balcony. It's a pretty nice view up there, right? On the balcony. Got a nice view up there. You're not looking over somebody's head. You're looking down. And so she thought, hey, I want to sit up there. And she had my granddaughter with her. And then after the service, the front row person said, hey, your daughter and your granddaughter is in your office. They're waiting for you. I went, what? And then I went in there, and I went in, and she was waiting outside the door. She was waiting on me. And then I thought, oh. So I walked up to her. I said, her name's Rachel. So I said, hey, Rachel, listen, about that grandparent thing, you know, intelligence, skipping over a generation. I was just having fun with the people, you know. It was a joke. And she goes, oh, hold on, Dad. It's okay. And I said, it is? She goes, yeah, I understand. In fact, I think you're right. You do? And she said, yeah. You know, just a couple weeks ago, Grandma and I had the same discussion. It's always good to learn from your mistakes and improve on what I need to be better at. Like not saying this for a second time in a row. In fact, you know, here's one area of my life that I wanted to improve on, and I had to make mistakes in order to learn from that. When I first came on board New Hope, 5 years later, I moved positions. They moved me from here to a place, to a ministry called Community Care. Community Care is all about praying, rebuilding people's lives, life change. There's recovery groups, prayer and healing, just a whole bunch of ministries in Community Care. So, first week on the job. And this was back in the days, and there was another pastor here named Dominic Ka'ahui. Yeah, Dominic. And every day I used to go and visit with him. We were good friends. So first week on the job, I go visit Dominic, and I can see that he's busy. He's got a lot of stuff. He didn't cut the weight. He had too many stuff on his plate, and he said, hey, listen, I'm supposed to take this form down to Queens Medical Center. His friend, a friend named Robert, got into a moped accident. He's at Queens. Can you take this over to him and have him sign this paper? It's for benevolence. And then I said, sure, I can do that for you. So I took the paper down there, have Robert sign the paper, came back. Record time. And then I walk into Dominic's office, and he's on the phone. So I go to step out, and he goes, no, come inside, sit down. So I sit down, and I didn't know this, but Dominic was talking to Robert, the guy I just went to the hospital for. And so Dominic's going, yeah, oh, I'm so sorry. And he goes, and then he starts praying for the guy. And then he hangs up. And then Dominic, in his most eloquent pidgin English, Hawaiian dialect, he says this, bruh, you didn't pray for the guy. And I said, what do you mean pray? You just told me to have him sign the paper. So I fly the paper down at him. I said, oh, you're from Community Care. You're supposed to pray for people. So that was my learning experience. And then Dominic goes like this. He goes, ah, it's okay. God knew you was going to blow it anyway. And he does. He knows when we're going to fail. But learn from those mistakes, those failures, and grow from that. Grow from that. It's always good to learn from your mistakes and improve what I need to improve on. In Proverbs 1:5, it says, let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning get guidance. I need guidance. Pastor Wayne writes in his book, Sifted, he says this, remember, it takes a long time to learn how to teach, and even longer to learn how to learn. Don't ever stop learning. See, don't ever think you're a know-it-all, because the day you think you are KIA, you're a know-it-all, you're dead in the water. There's a story that's told back in 1973. Gary Kildall wrote the first operating systems for personal computers, and he called it CPM. Now, IBM officials wanted to write an operating system for their personal computers, so they went after Gary Kildall. In 1980, they made an appointment to see Gary, but when the day that they went calling on this guy, he snubbed him, and he went off and flew his brand new airplane. They tried meeting with him time and time again. You know, they were so frustrated with this guy for standing them up. IBM then turned to a guy named Bill Gates, who owned a small company called Microsoft and his operating system called MS-DOS. 14 years later, Bill Gates was worth more than $8 billion. Kildall had since died, but he was a smart guy. But he didn't realize how big the operating system would become. In a similar way, church, people who think they know it all, they don't often realize how big God's kingdom will become. When God comes calling you with the offer of a lifetime, refuse to find other things to do, to be distracted with things that you feel should be on my plate. Cut some of those things so you're not distracted. You know, in the Bible, remember when Jesus passed by the fig tree and there was no fruit? Fruit on a fig tree is like growth in the church. When Jesus comes walking through those doors of the church, he's going to walk in here and I know exactly what he's going to say. Look at all these leaders, all of you. Look at all this good fruit in the church. Learning is a lifestyle of leadership. Never stop growing. Never stop stretching. Elasticity, right? Here's your application. Be a lifelong learner. Always look for ways to keep on growing and keep on learning in your character and in your skills, even through the mistakes. The best way to do that is take a regular look at yourself. Evaluate yourself. Take inventory. Ask yourself, where can I learn to grow? Where can I find training for what I want to learn? But keep on learning. Even if you have to make a learning plan, do that. There's a couple of things that I do to keep on learning. Every day I do my devotion. One new insight, right? One new insight, one new thing, one new skill. I do my devotions every day. So I'm learning one new insight every day. Another thing is I make it a goal to read one book a month. That's my own personal goal. You can do it how you want. You can do what you want. But I've just given you an example of keep on learning, keep on growing. Did you know that 33% of high school graduates will never pick up another book again after they graduate? 42% of college graduates will never pick up another book after they graduate. Your future leadership depends solely upon what you make of it. Make a commitment to keep on growing as a leader, as a follower of Jesus Christ, and as a person. Both, all three are the same person in one. That's all of us. Keep on learning. Be a lifelong learner. That's number one. And then number two, preach the word and hear the word. Preach the word and hear the word. In 2 Timothy 4, 1 and 2, it says, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, I give you guys this charge, everyone here. Paul gives you this charge, but I'll take credit. I'll read it to you. Not take credit, sorry. I'll give you this charge. Preach the word, be prepared in and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instructions. Here, I'll let you in on a well-known fact. A lot of the staff here at New Hope, they know this. I know this. I've been in New Hope since 96, and when coming on staff in 2001, I started seeing this in Pastor Wayne, observing how he teaches, how he guides this church. And you know when the Bible says, preach the word and be prepared in and out of season. This is Pastor Wayne. In the church, outside of the church, he can be talking about anything. Horses, Oregon, he can be talking about playing golf. He'll always match it up with the word of God. That's what he does. It's like the word of God is sown in his heart and in his mind. He can pull up stuff left and right. He'll just match everything that he's talking about with the word of God. He'll back it up with scripture. The most interesting man. That's influence. Preach the word and we get to hear the word every day of our lives. Now, Paul says to Timothy, preach the word of God and nothing else. Stand ready to do it at all times and in all kinds of situations, in season and out of season. St. Francis says this, it's no use walking anywhere to preach unless your walking is your preaching. Yeah? Now, Paul goes on to say this in 2 Timothy, "For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itchy ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths." Paul says, if you're going to talk about Jesus, represent him well. Meaning, preach only what's in the Bible. Don't go adding any kind of stuff on top of the Bible. He warns us that in the last days, people will be lovers of themselves. And they will continually be seeking knowledge, but never able to walk the talk. They'll start adding all kinds of stuff on the Bible. Hey, you ever see on these bookshelves, sometimes you pull out these old books, been sitting there like for decades, and you pull out the book, and then there's these brown like glue on the book and black dots on top. It's kind of look like that. And then and you look on the bindings and the pages on the outside, you got all this black stuff on top. You know what that is? That's cockroach droppings. Yeah. Cockroaches are like the plague of domestic civilization, right? So this is what Paul is saying to Timothy, to beware of compromising and speaking heresy instead of sound doctrine. Paul called these people false teachers. False teachers are like the cockroaches of today. They add droppings onto the Word of God. They put stuff on the Word that shouldn't have been added in. So, how do we endure sound doctrine and avoid the so-called itchy ear syndrome? I want you to read this with me. It's in Titus 1:9. Everybody, nice and loud. Ready, go. "He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that we can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it." See, scriptures were not given for your information, but for your transformation. If you're going to preach the right word, you got to hear the right word. And in order to hear the right word, you got to be close to the Lord, close to God. You know, when you're driving around, And you got the radio on, the clearest reception that you receive on that radio is when you're closest to the source, to that tower, radio transmitter, broadcasting transmitter, the tower. So let's say you're driving in Honolulu, and most of the towers are in Honolulu, I would assume. The radio station towers, they're in Honolulu. But you know when you drive through the Ko'olau's, the mountain range, Pali, Leaky Leaky, Wilson Tunnel, H3, and then you get on the other side, on the windward side of the Ko'olau's. The reception is still there, but it's not as clear as if you was right close to the source. And the further out you drive through the north, like La'ie or Haula, you get totally cut off. You're driving away from the transmitter, from the source. That's what happens in the spiritual realm. When we are spiritually close to God, we can hear him clearly. I mean, the word just pops up at us. But as we start drifting away and driving further and further, we are deliberately running away from God, for instance. The signal gets weaker, and it becomes harder to hear his voice. You know, it's at that point we become vulnerable to hearing other voices contrary to God's. Get closer to him. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." See, his sheep hear him speak because they're following him. They're close to him. Here's your application. If you want to hear God's voice again, turn the car around and come right back on this side of the island, next to the tower, and then you can hear him clearly. Here's a joke, okay? Disclaimer this now. Some people come up to me and they say, when I'm going to Kaneohe or Kailua. Nothing wrong with that place. I'm just saying. It's just a joke. Now you're coming into God's country, right? You ever heard people say that? They tell me that all the time. If you live in Kaneohe, Kailua, God bless you. You say, now you're coming into God's country. What is that? God is all over the place. So here's what I tell them. You know what? God visits you in Kaneohe and Kailua, but he lives in town. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. If you want to hear God's voice, turn the car around and come back to this side. Draw close to God in your heart And you'll begin to hear his voice speaking to you again. Get back to Jesus. He's the answer. Don't care where you're at. Jesus is the answer. So number one, be a lifelong learner. Number two, preach the word and hear the word. And then finally, number three, finish the race. Finish the race. Don't email me your Windward offense, please. I was just joking. Finish the race. This is my life scripture, in fact. 2 Timothy 4:7, we add in 8 here. It says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. Oh, appearing. The Bible often compares the Christian life to that of a race. And it begins the moment you say yes to Jesus. The day you raised your hand and said yes to Jesus, whole new life started for you. And it ends the day that God comes to take you home to be with him forever, when you die. Paul knew that his death was near, but he had no regrets. Because the day that he started following Jesus, oh, his whole life changed. Jesus took a hold of his life, and Paul lived the life to its fullest, fulfilling all that Jesus had charged him to do. In fact, the entire book of 2 Timothy, I call it Paul's famous last words. There once someone called into community care. This year, just this past year, they call and their grandfather was in the hospital dying of cancer. They knew that the time was short because he couldn't eat anymore. And they asked if someone could come down and pray for him. So I thought I'd go do it, you know, have the pastor go down. So I went down to the hospital. And then when I got there, I could see that cancer has gotten the better of him. And he was kind of emaciated, lost plenty of weight, but he still could communicate with me. I talked with him. I prayed with him. And as I was praying and finishing up, the doctor comes in. And then when I was done, the doctor tells the family, the diagnosis doesn't look good. The old guy, all of a sudden, he gets up and he tells the doctor this. He says, what do you mean the diagnosis doesn't look good? It looks better for me than it does for all of you. I'm going to heaven. You guys are still stuck here. Right? This guy, he had a grip on what was happening, how he was going to finish the race. He knew that Jesus was on the other side. See, you were made for a purpose, for a reason. God put you on this earth for a reason. And how you finish the race will make a difference, not only in your life, but for those around you, because everybody's watching. People are watching you, how you walk and how you talk. The race that God planned for you. His plan and purpose for your life. It's not a flat terrain. There's hills and valleys, bumps and curves and bruises along the way. And to finish the race of life, you don't have to have speed. It's not you be the first one there. No, you need endurance. Why do we need endurance? Because a lot of people don't finish the race well. You need endurance. It's like running a marathon. Now, I've run a couple of marathons back in the days, and the first time I ran a marathon, 26 miles, it's about the 20-mile mark where you come to a point in that race where you experience what we call hitting the wall. Huh? Hitting the wall is when you try to drink, you hydrate along the way, but by the time you hit that wall, that's it. Water, Gatorade, those protein gels, they just go right through your system. Your legs become numb, muscle coordination is difficult, and then doubt starts to set in. I wonder if I'm going to finish this race. Yeah? You know what it feels like? It feels like this. It feels like an elephant jumped out of the tree, landed on my back, and now I got to carry this thing all the way to the finish line. From the 20-mile marker to the 26-mile finish line. That's what it feels like. In life, all of us go through times when we seem to hit the wall. Sometimes we see it coming, many times we don't. These walls seem to come in different forms, and they all have a different purpose. They are there to test us to be a lifelong learner. Walls challenge us to preach the word and hear the word. Walls offer us a goal to reach, to finish the race. My goal in life is to finish the race well. I want to stand up before Jesus one day and have him say, "Hey, you made it. You finished well. Well done, my good and faithful servant." And not only that, it's not my goal, but it's also to see all of us. I want to see every single person in here finish the race well. There's over 600 people sitting in here. And when we all said yes to Jesus, that meant one day we're going to end up in heaven. Yeah? Because we said yes. And I want to see us all finish well. I want every one of us to become a lifelong learner, to learn one new thing every day. And then to preach the word and hear the word, to hear the word clearly and stay true to scriptures. And then finally, to finish the race well, that God has you keeping your eyes on him, keeping your eyes on Jesus. We can only do that if Jesus is in our hearts.